of a public good and the import of the public good in terms of a public being linked to a public finance regime and institutions. The entire context of the shifting boundaries between the state and the markets, and I think the fourth also a contextual issue, which is the shifting understanding of what is public and what is private. So I think Professor Pethe asserted in the morning that housing essentially is a private good. But given also the segmentedness of the market, what I'm going to talk about really, how this has been constructed as a public, and especially in the post-independence phase in India. So if one looks at the overall analysis of policies in the post-independence phase, clearly one sees that housing was seen as an issue which was linked to the way in which colonialism existed. And therefore, how do you, so which was essentially in the urban sphere linked to an issue of partial planning, not covering the entire city. It was linked to injustice and therefore people being left out, and the issue of neglect of particular areas. So how do you tackle this? By actually doing a comprehensive plan, bringing everything under state control, and that there has to be a very active intervention by the state in the land and housing markets. And obviously, therefore, seeing markets as being extremely inimitably public interest. So then, if you see this operationalization, I think it's been in the form of a variety of schemes. There was no housing policy at that time, but there were several social housing schemes, employee housing, in which employers were actually given incentives, in some cases even in the form of lands, in order to create townships for their employees. The same was done also by the state in order to create large townships of state employees themselves. Rental public housing, which was done by state public housing boards. And there was another form of cooperative housing, which I would say is like a mid between a part state subsidy plus a private initiative coming together, and people clubbing together, or people of small means clubbing together. And I think slum as a distinct segment of this entire housing scenario, where initially in these many years there was an issue of clearance. Very clearly, they thought that slums was an aberration and they needed to be cleared. But gradually this started giving way to a policy of tolerance with provision of some basic services. And what both of these policies do together is that they establish slums as a informal, as a parallel market which existed in cities. And I'm insisting that it is a parallel market at this point. How did this actually operationalize itself? I'm going to look at four big segments which really matter within the overall context of the country. So one is in terms of land, and which I think is the most critical in the overall context of India. Where when we became independent, private property was considered as a fundamental right, was part of the fundamental rights. And gradually there was a shift from locating land as private, looking at private property as a right, fundamental right, towards a regime which clearly placed land under eminent domain. And not only was land placed under eminent domain, there were several laws which were passed which facilitated acquisition and intervention in private land. Additionally, there was this entire expansion of state intervention in informal settlements. So slum acts in some ways, which were passed by several state governments, are a way in which whether it is institutional lands belonging to the local governments or the state governments or the central governments, but situating the slum as a distinct category where the state can intervene. So the locus standi of the state in intervening in these settlements was established via the slum acts. And all of this made property rights regimes extremely complex, and the knowledge of land made very, very difficult to decipher. So occupancy regimes also flourished within this. So that's, I think, in terms of land. If one looks at finance, in this entire regime, the focus on finance was very limited. In fact, access to finance itself was highly limited, and it was confined to public sector, both at a bulk level. So public housing boards got finance from institutions like Housing and Urban Development Corporation. They highly depended on this state finance. And at a retail level, it used to be public sector banks, but where access was very, very limited. The actual institutional face of housing intervention used to be the public housing boards. And these were enabled by land acquisition laws. In fact, many of the public housing board laws have specific provisions for land acquisition with state housing as a public good, and therefore enables specific land acquisition for housing itself. Okay? And besides that, there were land transfers by other departments to these public housing boards, and who were supported by public sector finance. Their employee and their overall organizational structure is supported by state governments. And yet, at any given point, one sees that these public housing boards were only able to achieve about maximum, if one sees, about 15% of the overall housing needs in any city. If one looks at building and building rules and planning norms, I'm sorry that that section is invisible or partly visible, but basically one sees that from the 1970s, the regimes of these planning rules and these development control norms actually started becoming very, very strong and very particular in cities. And again, with this overall logic that, so, and one needs to understand the different scales at which planning and building control regimes took place. So it was at a city level, local government level, it was at a state government level, and then gradually, if one sees in the 1990s, these are also involving central government as well when it comes to EIA and other kind of norms. So if one looks at the overall status and outcomes of this particular construction of locating housing as a public, and in the states, from a state framework, this is how it has been constructed, then one sees that this public sector housing could rarely reach the poor, or it could very rarely even reach the working classes. Most of it was being appropriated by those in the public sector or those who were close to corridors of power. Reducing rental markets, again something which is extremely evident, whether this was an intended outcome or perverse outcome of all the intervention in the land and housing markets, but one consistently sees that rental markets in cities almost came to a zilch, hardly any presence at all. What all of this also did is it created a nexus political economy of land and housing markets, where you basically see developers, politicians, bureaucracy, all coming together. So it's not just an issue of information asymmetry. It is a information monopoly, finance monopoly, but and extending in the till the 1980s roughly to even monopoly over essential products for the housing industry like cement. So all of these were also linked to this entire nexus, and as a result, one sees that the needs of the urban poor were really served through the informal markets, which became an increasing and a consolidated sector. Next. I'll come now straight to the post-millennial redefinition here. And first, let's look at how all of these subcomponents have started being reached. Okay? So even before there is a redefinition of housing, each of these subcomponents, which really propel and one sees housing as a front face But there are all of these factors in the background. So land ceiling laws began to be repealed. So earlier there were conditionalities and several exceptions which were created to the application of land ceiling laws. But then in the 2005, these actually began to be seen. In fact, very interestingly, in Maharashtra, I think there is a statement by the then chief minister who says that once we repeal the Urban Land Ceiling Act, Maharashtra is going to be seeing a spurt of affordable housing. So something which was in the earlier era seen as a move which would create affordable housing now began to be seen as a barrier to affordable housing, and this was almost seen as part of an entire reform package. Then the new land acquisition law, which came up in 2013, revised subsequently in 2014, these land acquisition acts, which jig the entire terms of land acquisition, and as an outcome really restrict in some ways the role of the state. But at the same time, if one looks at the overall state of land, then property rights regimes within the country continue to be extremely complex. And the state still continues to hold a significant control on land. It is also one of the biggest landowners, with the landowner itself not knowing often the details of its lands. So there are, there is a huge complexity around this land. Finance, one sees this is one sector which has been increasingly liberalized, especially after the 1990s, very globalized also. So today it is the one sector where there is a 100% FDI which is allowed. There is a presence of, and one can directly invest across linked properties, something also linked to the global regimes. But yet one sees that finance at a retail level sees a very, very low penetration in India. So even now, if you start looking at the housing finance penetration, it is barely 7% that one sees. So most housing in India continues to be constructed with informal loans or friendly loans or whatever. And perhaps also linked to the absence of recovery mechanisms, a point which Rashini also brought in. If one looks at planning, now the regime of planning is now sought to be reconstructed in the post-millennial years. The comprehensiveness of something called a development plan, that being linked to building control and developmental control regimes, that is kind of completely dismantled. And one sees that there is a much more project approach, I would say what is called contingent planning, as an approach which is being followed, and which almost kind of accepts that there are going to be several disjuncts between infrastructure and settlement, that they need not go hand in hand. The role of public housing boards, there has been like a spate of policies since the 1990s and 2000s. So I can't tell you how many policies in housing sector we have seen. So earlier we saw only schemes, but after 1990, so the first housing policy in India came in 1994. But after that, there has been a national housing policy in 1998. There is an urban housing and habitat policy which came up in 2005. Various state governments came up with their own state housing policies from 2006 to 2008. That has then been followed by affordable housing policies at a national level, then at a state level. We now also have a rental housing policy. So there is like a spate of housing policy. It's like it's one of the most policied sector in India. But in many of these, the role of public housing boards now is completely shifted. From being providers, they are expected to be now facilitators. Okay? Now, what that facilitation means exactly is not very clear. But what one sees very clearly is that their own land stocks have dwindled. None of the state governments or the central governments now do land transfers to them. And as a result, they are compelled to buy land at market rates. So this changes the entire economics of public housing itself. And the flow of finance to them has also reduced significantly. The laws which created them haven't changed. So that shell still remains intact, but what happens in between all of those terms have really changed completely. And it is in this context that one begins to see the top of PPPs. So Darshini talked of the first experience of PPPs being in the slums that were in Mumbai. And this has been the stated need. We in Mumbai, in Maharashtra, we saw the first PPP in 1991 with the slum redevelopment project. Speak a little bit in detail. But the overall rationale, as we, I think, something which is very familiar in terms of, I think, Soumen also iterated this in the beginning when he talked about the positive argument which we like. So I will say the first experimentation with PPPs in India is what is now within. There are like two papers which have been published by the Government of India which talk about approach to PPPs in India. And this has been done with significant consultation with the real estate industry as the primary stakeholder. And it defines two broad approaches and two broad models to PPPs. One is what is called the brownfield model. The other is the greenfield model. Okay? And one basically sees this consistent with what is unfolding. So I'm going to try to relate both of this. So this early experimentation is largely with the brownfield models. And it's interesting to see how it has unfolded. One of the most, I think, implemented of these PPPs is what is the slum redevelopment schemes in Mumbai. And I will, without kind of, because if I start talking about slum redevelopment, I can't stop. So I'll just very, very briefly outline what are the core principles here. So one is you commoditize land. Okay? And here it is essential to recognize that slums in Mumbai occupy some of the most central lands, which people have struggled with, some of the most uninhabitable places, but which have now come within the central areas of the city. That land is commoditized. And if you start looking at what is the role of developers and the private sector here, then the developers take responsibility from formulation of the project, the design of the project, the construction of the project, the allotment which is to be made, and free houses need to be given to slum dwellers. Okay? So all of this is the role of the developers. Besides also financing this, what does the state do? The state role is to basically grant approval to the scheme. It has to grant the incentive floor space index or the transfer of development right, which basically enables them to build for profit, the state. And to determine eligibility, that is the state role. And therefore, I'm trying to place this in the PPP terms, what is the role of both of these bodies. I'll talk about the outcomes of this later, but this is the term, those are the terms which evolved. Okay? If you look at now, currently, there is again a brownfield project which is being experimented in Delhi. And here again, you see similar kind of lines, except the insistence that the redevelopment has to be in situ, okay? That there is no shift of any dweller from that place. And they are provided for some tighter monitoring by the state government. Okay? But other than that, most of the terms are the same to what has been described in Mumbai. There is another scheme that I see in the offing, which is a slum redevelopment come market development scheme in Bangalore. So then this is not just perhaps cashing in on the slum, but it also wants to create a mall. So it's like a combination of a housing plus market development kind of a scheme, but largely along these lines. Let me look at what is greenfield, and a lot of these elements are incorporated within what Darshini earlier talked about as the PMAY, the Prime Minister's Awas Yojana, the key policy which adopts PPP as a framework for this. So what does it say? One, if you look at land acquisition, key issue. So the land acquisition will be facilitated by the public sector, but the costs are to be borne by the developer. In practical terms, what has often happened is that this has meant that several public sector entities are in fact giving lands to developers at cost. Okay, so this is not free land which is being given, it's being given at a circle rate, whatever is the prevalent circle. Then, and it may have been land which has been acquired for very different purposes. So one of the key issues currently in this state, Maharashtra, is where MIDC, industrial lands, lands which were acquired from the public at very low rates in the name of industrial developments, are being given for residential development. So it's a very interesting shift which is happening. The approval here, there are state level committees and there are central level sanctioning committees, the structures which were created in the period of the JNNU, and where all regulatory approvals are to be facilitated by the public sector. So here there is a big incentive for the private sector, because the overall regulatory regime in India is so fragmented and divided that there are, I think, several studies which talk about the number of permissions which are to be taken, which range from something like 60 to 80, the time and the transaction cost which is associated with all of these regulatory regimes. Here, the incentive is that this will be like a one-window approach, and there will be pre-approvals which will be granted if the project is selected as a PPP project under the PMAY. The responsibility of the public sector is a demand survey. And I will briefly get into what is a demand survey later, but seems to be one of the most dubious kind of mechanisms, where online there are interests which are invited of people who fall into affordable housing category, which are the economically weaker sections, lower income groups, and the middle income groups. So they have to online register for these demand surveys. I have gone through several websites of the government and the state governments to see whether I can avail of a form. You can't. So and there are interesting stories around all of this as well. Allotment is to be done by a developer. So it is the developer who selects and judges whether the beneficiary belongs to the particular income category. Right? There is a self-affidavit which is submitted by the beneficiary, and the allotment is done by the developer. There is a finance which is linked to this, which the entire responsibility is left to the lender. And the lender in this case largely linked to banks, the housing finance companies, and the land. There is a, now a national housing fund which has been created under the national budget. The project construction, the way the cycle runs is that there are free sale components to be, which should be developed first, because the intention is that these projects should be mixed projects with all income groups, with free sale components as well as affordable housing components. And dependent on the proportion of affordable housing within a particular project, there are subsidies which are given to the supply side, as in the developers, financial subsidies, which range up to from a minimum of about 30,000 per unit, where there are less than 10% affordable housing units, to projects in which there are 40% affordable housing units, the subsidy can range up to 100,000 rupees per unit. There are also demand side subsidies, and demand side subsidies are given to the allottees of these projects. But these are largely in the form of interest subventions, and where the interest is brought till about 600,000 rupees, the interest rate is capped at something like 6.5%. If the loan is greater than 600,000 rupees, then you have to pay the regular lending rate. What do I see happening in this entire process? I think that one is really redefining the public itself. So one question here is this being seen as a welfare, and where this is particularly coming from an analysis of several of the brownfield projects. Since 2000, if I see all of this policy making, the emphasis on several of the urban development programs, where housing is a very, very big component of the budgets and especially directed at slums, brownfield developments, then one of the things that one really sees is this, why is housing being made the central point of welfare as opposed to provision of basic services? So we often have a situation very interesting in Mumbai where you can get a free house, but you cannot get water, right? So these kind of very, very interesting kind of contradictions which are being created, again, not just in Mumbai, but in several cities. So all of those houses which Darshini showed photographs of, whether it is in Bhopal, whether it is in Indore, whether it is in Ahmedabad, they're all being done in the name of rehabilitation, housing. So this brownfield is becoming a very, very big component. The second is, if you start looking at then the greenfield waters, for whom the big ambition which is reiterated in several of the national policies today is for all by 2022. So what is this all? And what is this housing? So the way it is defined is anybody who has no other house in any part of the country. Now that creates for a very funny situation, because most people in India, to cities, may be migrants, yeah. But there may be some house in back in the village. So it is an interesting situation, and this is to be given by a self-effort. Then the locations of these houses, which are largely emerging in the peripheries of cities, because those are perhaps the spaces which are now being colonized, or where expansions or real affordable land for developers is actually identified. So how far do you move? Okay, one is, so there is a particular construct of affordability which is also being put. Then if one looks at the substance of definitions, who is EWS, who is LIG, and one sees here that EWS is anybody who has an income, annual income, family income of less than 300,000. The LIG is any household income, annual income of less than 6 lakhs. Just to kind of put matters in reference, because otherwise these numbers don't make sense. I think most postgraduate first jobs are roughly 25,000 to 30,000 rupees per month, which would amount to making that person a LIG, not EWS, but LIG. 3 to 6 lakhs is LIG. Less than 3 lakhs is EWS. So what is more likely to happen in this expansion of our income parameters which have been broadened is that the benefits are likely to be pursued by a very different category, and in fact we are invisibilizing the entire social housing segment within these kind of redefinitions of for whom is housing being constructed. We are also redefining housing as a substance. And so we, and the sole parameter to define housing, its quality, is affordability. A huge shift away from the entire notion of adequacy, which was at one point in time talked about by the UN. Okay? And adequacy itself as a socio-cultural parameters, it talks of security of tenure, it talks of locations, infrastructures, accessibility. So all of those parameters now don't count. What counts is affordability, which again perhaps links to the point that Eliza, you brought. Second, for whom are we talking about affordability? And the overwhelming concern, at least in India, seems to be that it has to be affordable to the supply side, to the suppliers, and without consideration to the demand side. Then one is also very clearly placing housing as a product which has to be created through markets for all classes. We are, through the brownfield developments, linking informal markets to formal housing markets with its own implications, while retaining significant controls on land, land policies, land markets. And in fact, there is a discretionary use of these controls to create a partnership with the private sector. The third facet that we need to recognize is that there is a shift towards property and not occupancy, which has been a part of the big access to housing story in India. And this means that you move towards formalization of structure, you demolish existing structures. So there is this entire discourse since the last 15 years where we constantly talk of a housing shortage in India. And what is housing shortage? Is that anybody who lives in slums is considered like part of the housing shortage. So there is an entire discourse which kind of shift towards that. And there is a shift in the access regimes. How do you create those access? You're definitely not talking of land-based constraints. So that's again in terms of housing. In converting to the property, one is also trying to shift away from any land interventions, like whether it is sites and services, whether it is enabling group or collective access to land. And therefore, access to new land for people who are vulnerable is increasingly fraught with difficulty. Because what has now happened with all of these linkages between informal and formal housing markets is that informalization itself has also become a tool in the hands of the powerful. If something which began as a very much a strategy of the poor to access and claim the city is something which is being turned into a tool for the city. We're also redefining the roles. So, forming, converting, and with respect to land and housing, there is the sole role which is being played. Developers were becoming central to the entire the role of public housing boards as secondary or even peripheral. And it's become so peripheral today. Having no land stock, having to buy land from the market at market rates, or forming partnerships or joint ventures with developers, with having no access to finance at far lesser rates. What this means is that the houses which are put up by public housing boards, one often sees that they themselves lose all their affordability when they are renting. And the role of the state and central governments who are seeing their entire equation today of housing is, and the role in relation to housing is to become a facilitator for developers. Okay? So one increasingly sees conferences in this sector is like a transaction and a negotiation over the table between developers, their associations and officials of the state. There seem to be no other stakeholders in the picture at all. Okay? So those are being completely peripheralized. So I think one needs to, through all of this, really outline what are the gains, who is bearing the risk, what are the risks, what threats are being proposed, who are the losers in all of this. And I think we need to look at these related things for the poor, for the government, for agents of the state, and for developers themselves. So, like, if I am to make conclusions on this, what is happening to these PPP models, without defined entitlements, property rights, and regulatory regimes, PPPs are extremely vulnerable. And in fact, they are undermining the very objects for which they are being created. That they are creating undue benefits for developers and agents. Having traced some of the slummy development schemes in Mumbai, I can easily say that these schemes create profits in the range between 200% to 300% per project. They strengthen the nexus political economy of land and overall make housing inaccessible. Even greenfield projects are more likely to result in the capture, wastage, and leakage of public resources, because what one sees is that this is leading to a construction mania for which there is no real demand that has been seen, especially the entire mismatch between locations, amounts, the scale at which this housing is being created. And that this adoption of a PPP approach, which is being sent, is unlikely to make a dent in the overall informalization of housing. Last slide. So then, I think, where would I come? So status of public housing as a public good is definitely debated, because this is a sector where there is a considerable amount of occupancy, owner involvement, or even occupant involvement, I would say, not just owner involvement, and it leads towards that. But that it is extremely critical to welfare. So one needs to really use perhaps and move beyond the debate of public and private goods when it comes to housing, perhaps even evolve newer terms to describe what are the critical issues and name those rather than getting stuck with the public and private good dimension. Social housing, one knows, has often been treated as a public good. But the real contradiction that we see in India and the contemporary movement is where housing is being treated as a good which is intended for the public. Or in the case of brownfield developments, it is forced upon the public. It is produced by the private sector in both the brownfield and the greenfield sectors. And it is incentivized by the use of public resources like land and now finance. So with this, basically, I think it is going to result neither in a cost saving, nor the efficiency, nor the scaling up. So even in terms of the entire argument for PPP, we don't seem to be reaching